The next step in setting up sales tax for Sage Intacct Construction Edition is to go into our transaction definitions, and we need to enable subtotals. So if you go at the top level and you go down into, in this case, we're going to go into order entry, but you would need to do the same thing in purchasing and inventory. But we're going to go into order entry, and we're going to decide on which one of these transaction definitions is going to have the ability to charge sales tax. And if that is all of them, then you need to set up the subtotals in each definition. We're going to use QuickBill for our example today. So I need to go into Setup, Transaction Definitions. And again, this will be from the top level. And once I'm in there, I'm going to go find the definition that I want to make sure sales tax gets calculated on. And that's the QuickBill invoice right there. So I'm going to click Edit. And in the first tab, in the general tab, if you scroll down far enough, there's going to be an accounting section, and you should see a transaction subtotals. And you want to make sure you check off Enable Subtotals. So if you don't have this checked off, you may not see this information in here. Once you click Enable Subtotals, you're going to have this section here that you can fill out. And this is the typical setup that we would recommend. Description, sales tax, some kind of general description that this is going to be a sales tax line. Subtotal type, it's going to be a charge. You can also set up discounts here as well. It's going to apply to line one, which is going to be the subtotal, which is line one. And in this case, it's a percent value. We're not going to put the value in because the value is being determined by our tax details that we set up in the earlier sessions. And then we're going to go ahead and fill out, is this entry going to be a default credit entry, debit entry on the purchasing side? So in this case, it's a credit entry, and it's going to go to sales tax payable. And again, this is going to override, there's going to be defaults on this based on your tax details and tax groups. So this will, if you have a unique account set up in there, it'll override that. But the offset account, you know, when we collect the sales tax, what's the offset account? In this case, accounts receivable, you're going to want to set up. On the purchasing side, it'll be accounts payable. And the key here is to make sure you check it off and you tell the system that this is a tax line. And when you select that, it's going to actually go through and look at your advanced tax setup to figure out what should go there and be overridden. Okay, so you just want to go and make sure that this is checked off as is tax. And then you do have an option, depending on how you want to show it on your invoice, to show expanded tax details or not. And what this is going to do is, again, if we talked in some earlier segments, is, you know, depending on how you want to set up your tax details, you might have a state portion and a county portion or a local portion. And you might need to see that broken out separately, both on your invoice or in your calculation. So basically, if you want to see it broken out separately by tax detail line, you can check this box off. Otherwise, it's just going to summarize it by those contact tax account groups that we had set up in the system. So we're going to leave ours unchecked. We're just going to summarize it as one line. So then once you do that, basically, you're going to go and say save. And then you would do that for each one of your transaction definitions that you need to turn tax on. And again, order entry, purchasing, you know, I'm just showing it on the receivable side, but it would be the same on the payable side. Just it would be the debit default, not the credit default on that side of the section. So once you're done getting those set up, those subtotals set up in your transaction definition, the next step is to go through and decide how you want to default your contact tax groups and basically go through that setup so that when we do create the invoice, for example, it knows which tax groups to pull from. So you have a couple options there. There's default settings in both the customer and vendor records where you can put in the default contacts, but you can also do some things with some ship to addresses, especially on the project side. So all of these. You know, one of the first things we set up was over in company, we set up these tax contact tax groups, and that's where everything is driven from. So by definition, contact tax group means the group is being set up at the contact level. So that's the key determining factor here, is it's not really set up at the customer or vendor level. It's set up at the contact associated with the customer, the contact associated with the vendor. So you have some flexibility there. So let's go ahead and go into the, let's go to accounts payable and let's go into the vendors. So when I go into the vendor list, if I know that this vendor is always charging me sales tax, I can go into the setup of the vendor. So let's go into Buffalo Building and I can click at it. And if you go to the additional information tab, and you scroll down, you're going to see a tax calculation setting. And in here, you're going to see, is this vendor taxable or eligible for tax? So you can check that off as taxable. And then what is the default tax group? So, you know, again, depending on how you want to default these, you may not fill one in here. But basically, there's our list we set up earlier. And you can select, yeah, this is Des Moines or 7% tax, whatever you have set up here. When you're doing that, it's actually saving it on that vendor's contact record in the system. So let's jump over to accounts receivable and look at that on this side. So if I go into customers and let's go into my Wegmans group and I'll hit edit and I'll go to my additional information and I go down here, I have a tax calculation for my Wegmans group. Primary contact by default, majority of the time when we work for Wegmans Group, we charge them tax to this tax group, Iowa Des Moines. So that's typically where you're going to set it up out of the box. If it's just strictly by customer, you could put in a default tax group right there. Now, you may find a scenario where, well, we're working on a job for the Wegmans Group and it's in a different area. Or it's exempt, there's different sales tax rules. So if I go into that specific project in the setup, and let me jump to include private here, I could get down to my entity level too. For example, we have one of the projects we're working on for Wegmans is Store 180, and that has different rules. That's not going to be the default rule for that customer. So what you can do is you can actually set up a second contact for that customer, and in this case, I called it Wegmans Store 180 and put the job number in. And in there, I can have a different tax rule. So what I would recommend doing is either the important thing to do here is you need to set up that contact inside the customer record. It needs to be associated with the customer record. So what I usually suggest, you can do this from the customer record directly, which we were in earlier. You can also, from the customer here, click View and get into the mailing addresses here. But actually, what I would recommend is going directly into the customer. So if you know you have a new project set up, I would go into the customer record where we were earlier. And I would go back into Wegmans Group. And I would go to my contact list. And you could do it either way. You can come into here, and anywhere you can get to the contact list, you can click Add. And once you click Add from the customer record, it's associating it with the customer. And from here, you can give it a new name. So in this case, I gave it just the, you know, I think I said the store name was 180. Let's say 181. And the first name is Wegmans Store. Actually, I think here's what I did. I did the job number. 20-, let's just pretend it's 011, and the first name is Wegmans Store 181. And then you can kind of see here, it's going to list out suggested contact name, print as. So however you want to show it on this entry screen, like I did here, you know, you could do it that way as well. So I'm just going to leave it like that for now. But the key is, once you set up that contact over in the additional information, you could put a completely different tax group here. So whenever that contact is used, we are going to use the exempt Des Moines tax group. And click Save there. And now I have, for that customer, I have two tax groups in there as well. You know, one I labeled the old way, one I labeled the new way. But I'm going to hit Cancel here and save it. And then what you can do is, under the Ship to Contact, you can select what the ship to is for that customer, if there is a default one. But in this case, you would do that in the project. So over in the project, now that we have that contact, we can come over here, and this again is on the customer side. And I can go into the, I'm sorry, I went to the wrong area here. I can go into projects, pull up that project, and in here, I can select my ship to contact to be either that new one I just did, or if you want to label it accordingly, I put the name in front so it'd be easier to sort. So we're going to say pull from this contact. And if I view this contact is set up to do the same thing, exempt Des Moines. Okay. So now we should be set up. So now when we do our invoice, because this is the ship to contact on the project, it should default that into the ship to, but you can always override that as well during the entry. And we'll see that in the next section. And then that will grab the contact tax group for the project that way as well. And you can do the same thing over on the payable side. You can actually set up a different one for the vendor based on the ship to as well. So basically now that will conclude this, the majority of the setup items that we need for sales tax setup. And in the next section, we'll go through putting in an invoice and kind of taking a look at how it works in the system.